Greetings, ladies and gentlemen. George Baker here at my home in Dallas, Texas. I'm seated at my Hauptwerk virtual organ. I received many positive comments about my first two micro lessons in organ improvisation, which have encouraged me to continue the series. This will be the third in the series of micro lessons. As I mentioned in the previous two videos, the idea of a micro lesson came from Pierre Cochereau's micro sonata, a short three-movement trio sonata that lasts less than 7 minutes. Pierre seemed to be very fond of the miniature, calling things micro this or micro that. Please subscribe to my YouTube channel to see the previous micro lessons, as well as future micro lessons. Each micro lesson will address a bite-sized principle upon which an improvisation could be built. This time, I'll speak of parallels, parallel intervals, and parallel chords. Today, we'll show examples of how Franck used parallel chords in all three chorales, but I'm getting ahead of myself a little bit. Let's go back in Western music history for a minute and talk about the earliest predecessor of polyphony, that of medieval organum. For hundreds of years, monophonic plain chant was used in churches and outside of churches. Improvisation was a primary way of creating music, since there were no written scores. Towards the end of the 9th century, there were descriptions of the chant melody being duplicated by a second voice, a perfect fourth or fifth below, with either voice possibly also duplicated at the octave. Unfortunately, we have no surviving written examples of such organum, as it was called, because written compositions only started to appear in the 11th century. And it was during the 11th century that the two voices began to show a little bit of independence using oblique and contrary motion as well as parallel motion. The consonant intervals back then were the unison, fourth, fifth, and octave. And it was much later that the third and the sixth became consonant intervals. During 1909 to 1910, the genius, brilliant French composer Claude Debussy wrote his first book of prelude for piano. Among them was an incredible piece entitled La Cathédrale Engloutie, or The Sunken Cathedral. Debussy begins with a parallel organum-like passage. While the organ isn't a piano with a damper pedal, obviously, you get the idea. Let me play just the first few chords of this piece. And so forth. Okay, let's fast forward to 1930 with Charles Tournemire's magnificent Gregorian paraphrase on the Easter sequence Victime Paschali Laudes. It's in mode one. The chant is doubled at the fourth and octave below. Let me just play a little snippet of that, and then after, we could use the same idea, but put it on a soft registration rather than the tutti, using a soft pedal point accompaniment underneath. Keeping the fourths going, we can improvise a perhaps communion or a short offertory or something like that. And we might change the accompanimental chords once, twice, or maybe three times during the little improvisation. So let's see what happens here. Or transposed. Very, very brief, but that kind of piece is so incredibly easy to improvise. Tournemire's student and my teacher, Jean Langlais, wrote his Suite Médiévale in 1947, shortly after he became organist at Sainte Clotilde. Let's hear the first few chords of this piece, sounding simultaneously ancient yet modern. So forth. So again, we have in use but with some chromaticism mixed in to take it into the 20th century. I think that is a beautiful piece. It's very short, 2 pages, highly recommended to every body. Now guys, you might think I grew up Catholic. I did not. I grew up Methodist, the son of a Methodist minister. But we can use the same concept, the same parallel force fifths for any tune, any hymn tune, such as the old 100th. For example, we can make a little fanfare before singing the Praise God, from whom all blessings flow in the Methodist Church. Something like this. Thank you. So you get the idea. This sounds impressive, it sounds hard, but it is incredibly easy to do. So try it out on your own if you would. Okay, as promised, let's travel back in time to 1890 when César Franck completed his trois chorales at the end of his life. Let's look at three short examples, one from each chorale. From chorales 1 and 2, we have passages with parallel dominant 7th chords. And then from chorale 3, we have a passage with parallel triads in the 2nd inversion. And I'll comment briefly when I get to that chorale number 3 spot. So here we are, César Franck in chorale number 1. Hear that dominant 7th? Another dominant 7th. Dominant 7ths, all of those. And then resolving to the E major. So again, we have that chain of dominant 7th chords in a row, or parallel 7th chords in a row. Jumping to the 2nd chorale, we have a very, very similar passage. Dominant 7th, dominant 7th, resolving to the F sharp major chord. So again, we have Now let's jump to the 3rd chorale. Here, he just has parallel triads in 2nd inversion. But there's a twist at the end, and I'll show you. Chord number 1, chord number 2, and that's the flat 2nd. There's our frigid cadence again. But look here, what's the next chord? That right there. You see the C is the 3rd of the chord. It's a minor 3rd, but in the A flat chord, it's a major 3rd. And that is something really important in the music of Jean Lang. So, we could play around with those parallel chords and it sounds fantastic, but it's really incredibly easy to do. The Impressionists Debussy and Ravel went further, adding parallel 9th chords to our chord libraries. Ravel's famous Pavane for piano was written in 1899. It's a 19th century piece, believe it or not. While he was still a composition student at the Paris Conservatoire, studying with Faure, I find it incredible to believe that Ravel was never the recipient of a first prize in composition. What a mistake. Nobody understood him or appreciated poor Ravel except Faure. But listen to his parallel 9th chords in the Pavane. Got the cadence back to the G major. But again, I find this cadence here. Those passing tones. Isn't that a beautiful piece? It's so simple. Apparently, Ravel took a disliking to it later on, but we still find it beautiful. And another really interesting thing about this piece is that it was dedicated to his patron, a lady named Winnaretta Singer, or otherwise known the Princesse de Polignac. She was an American woman who had inherited a fortune from her father, Isaac Singer, the inventor of the sewing machine. Isaac had moved his family to Paris shortly after the American Civil War. Winnaretta grew up primarily in Paris and developed a fantastic love for the arts and music. In 1892, in fact, she commissioned Aristide Caillebotte to build her an 18-stop orgue de salon, or a home organ. And most interesting is that the organ has an expressive grate, an expressive grand orgue, as well as an expressive swell, or récit. Isn't that interesting? I think so, in any case. A student of Gigou and Nadia Boulanger, the Princesse de Polignac also commissioned Francis Poulenc to write her an organ concerto, which was premiered in her music room on December 16th, 1938, with none other than Maurice Durufle at the organ. A mere 34 years after Franck's Trois Chorales, a young George Gershwin composed his Rhapsody in Blue. Let's hear a brief passage of parallel seventh chords. And then a few measures later, let's hear also some parallel 11th chords. All right, playing Rhapsody in Blue on the organ is not for the faint of heart, but I want to illustrate the harmonies of this passage, so I'm going to give it a go. Okay, so we have basically that's 11th chord. And then later on here, a few measures later, he's got this series of 11th chords going down a whole tone. So this is coming into jazz, where you have most chords have a seventh in them, and many have ninth, 11th, and even 13th as part of the chords. I love Gershwin, and I hope you do too, because he was an absolute genius. Died of a brain tumor. Incredible loss to us and to civilization. Ladies and gentlemen, the concept of parallels offers so many opportunities to create simple yet effective improvisations. Please give it a try, and I'll see you in the next video. If anyone is interested, my workbook in organ improvisation is still available at the low price of $50 plus tax, and you can order this book from our little music web store, baroquenotesmusic.com.